Good morning.
Good morning.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Stand up, if you will, as we begin our worship service. We're singing hymn number 277, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. And are any of you excited that it looks like we might have a white Christmas?
Yes.
Apparently some of you aren't, but that's okay. We're going to sing verse 1, 2, and 3 of Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Take a peek. Did I get that right, Lorraine? Okay. All right. A little something I wanted to read here today. I won't get in copyright problems. I'm in a little trouble with this copyright thing here lately. Some of this you've probably heard already or read. A little poem by Polish monk, Angelus Celius. Lo, in the silent night a child of God is born, and all is brought again that e'er was lost or worn. Could but thy soul, O man, become a silent night, God would be born in thee and set all things right. Christmas is the celebration of the event that set heaven to singing, an event that gave the stars of the night sky a new brilliance. Christmas tells us that at a specific time and at a specific place, a specific person was born. From the lips of him who came fell these words: the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Like piercing trumpets, these words heralded the breaking in of the divine to human history. They declare that heaven has come to our rescue and that God has not left us to stumble alone on earth's pathway. What a wonderful and glorious hope we have because of that first Christmas. We should get more amens than just one. Amen. There was one. Very good. All right. Now, where am I at here? Got the announcements out of the way. I guess we're going to stand and greet each other, but don't touch each other. The flu's going around and we don't want to spread it. So, everybody stand and greet each other. Yeah, do an elbow bump or something. If the ushers would come forward, please. Let's pray. Father, we come today to give thanks and to give praise as we celebrate the birth of Jesus. We come to celebrate that birth today. Father, we take up this offering to keep our church going, to keep this building going, to pay our bills. But let us keep in mind, Father, that this has nothing to do with our salvation. It was provided by that birth so many years ago. But Father, as we give, help us to give with a happy, cheerful heart that we are keeping the kingdom growing in this community, in this church. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
ask you to all stand as you're able. We'll sing our hymn of worship. Angels We Have Heard on High. We'll sing verses 1, 3, and 4. This song is called All Is Well. You know, I was just thinking about that. You know, if you look at it from the standpoint of the headlines and stuff, all is not necessarily well with the world right now. But the thing is, you know, we were separated, as it says in Romans, from God completely until our Savior came. And so this is reflecting on that night because, you know, Emmanuel, God is with us. And so all is well as far as our relationship being restored to God on the basis of faith in Christ, but also in the future we have to look forward to His kingdom to come, and then every tear will be wiped away, and none of this would happen if He hadn't chosen to come and die for us.
Angels is in the manger. See Male, see Male,
will you pray with me? Father God, as we come together this morning, what a powerful reminder for us that all is well. As John said, though sometimes this world screams and shouts about the problems, we know, God, that you are in control. We know, God, that you have a plan. And Father God, we just stop now in this service, in this moment, and say thank you. Thank you for the peace that we're able to enjoy through God, with God, as a result of what you have done, Lord. As we come together, we are mindful that there are many that are not here today because of illness or injury or traveling. And Lord, we lift them to you today and pray that you would bless and encourage them in a special way, that you'd pour upon them your love in a new way, that they would recognize it as coming from you. We thank you, too, for the many that are here, that perhaps on regular Sundays may not be. And Lord, we're glad for that. We rejoice in that and pray that you would just allow your Holy Spirit to work in each of our lives this morning as we worship you in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Will you listen now as the choir sings, What Child Is This? Thank you. the choir comes down to join you, the children may also be dismissed for Children's Church. And we thank John Call. He's a man of many talents. Not only does he sing, but he's also working with the children, with Mr. Brinkman, I believe, as well. We appreciate that. If you will, turn in your Bibles. We're continuing to look at Revelation chapter 5. And just to kind of, throughout the last couple of months, last 2 months really, we've been looking at Revelation chapter 5, verse 12, really. And before we read that together, I'm just going to bring you up to speed. I know some of you have been here every week and know everything that we've talked about. And I celebrate that with you. Over the last several months, or weeks rather, we have explored many different ideas from this passage of Revelation 5. We've seen the idea of worthiness, you know, and you will remember that when we say that Christ is worthy, it doesn't mean that he's deserving of something, although he is, but it also means that he is equal to these things that are describing him. We talked about the idea of receiving and how that word doesn't just mean that he got something, it means that he's taking up from what he is, taking up of his own and using it in our lives. Last week we talked about the idea of saying something. Did any of you say anything this week? Alex is the only one. And by the way, yesterday was Alex's birthday, so let's everybody say happy birthday to Alex. Alex, happy birthday. But to say, when it says that they said something, that meant that they looked at everything. They took in everything and they made a conclusion. They drew a conclusion based on what they had perceived. Then we looked at some of these different terms, some of these different qualifiers or characteristics, power, the ability to accomplish something. And we remember in Philippians 4 that it says we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us, right? It's not we can do all things through Pastor Matthew who strengthens us, because Pastor Matthew's strength is about that much. I can't hardly make it through the day myself. Don't expect me to give you the strength, right? We talked about riches, and we were reminded that everything belongs to Pastor Matthew, right? Everything belongs to God. Everything belongs to God. It is His. We talked about the idea of Thanksgiving on that week of Thanksgiving. And we were reminded that the word Thanksgiving, if you break it down and look at it, actually is a statement saying that God's grace works well. That's good, right? Joyce, say amen. Okay. We talked about the idea of wisdom. And you know, we think of wisdom as using knowledge appropriately, but wisdom in this capacity, in this context, it means clarity, free from ambiguity. And how are we able to have wisdom or clarity? Through God, because God doesn't change. You know, our culture, our opinions, our society, it changes. It changes, you know, it was different 10 years ago than it is today. It was different 30 years ago than it is today. It was different 50 years ago than it is today. Culture changes, but God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That's why we're able to have clarity. If God changed every other day, we'd never know where we stood. We'd never know what the truth is. We saw strength, the ability to overcome immediately. But we also were challenged because, you know, when we think of strength, we often think of the big, of the broad, of the dramatic. But we were reminded that God very often demonstrates His strength quietly in small, miraculous ways. Like that birth all those years ago. Now, I know some of you will say, well, a birth isn't normally quiet. But in quiet moments as well as the dramatic. And last week we saw the idea of honor. And that is really perceiving value. And we talked about how our Savior isn't a discount Savior, is He? We talked about how we consider what price we put on Christ, and we also thought about what price He places on us. You know what? Somebody has to like you at least a little bit in order to lay down their life for you. And we know that Jesus loves us, like that song says. when we talk about honor, it was that perceived value, that price. Today, we're going to continue as we draw ever closer to the end of this sermon series. Now, if you're clever, you'll figure out we got one more week in December, and that'll be the last in our sermon series. But we're going to look once again at Revelation chapter 5. If you'll stand as you're able, we're going to read verses 11, 12, and 13. And as we have done over the last several weeks, when I give you the sign, I'm going to have you read it with me. It says, "Then I looked and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne, the living creatures and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, 'Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing.' And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and such as are in the sea and all that are in them, I heard saying, 'Blessing and honor and glory and power be to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever.'" Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for its power, its truth. And we pray, Lord, as we consider it this morning, that you would speak to our hearts, that you would be pleased with what we do and say this day. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. You may be seated. As again we draw closer to the end of this passage, we're going to look today at words and actions. You know, we've looked at that a couple times, different words and different actions in here. We're going to start off by looking at a word that is very much connected with the Christmas story. Today is December 24th, you know, and as I've tried as we've gone through to bring some Christmas in to this, you know. I know I don't look very Christmassy. I got a nice Christmas tie on, and if you can see my socks, yeah. There you go. Here, I'll make it even easier. I know some of you complain when I take my shoes off, but... And in fact, if wherever you're seated, if you want to take your shoes off with the permission of your neighbors, you know, some of you might want to keep your shoes on. But anyways, one of the connections with the Christmas story I want to read is this word glory. And I'm going to read for you Luke chapter 2, verse 8 to 14. It's just a couple verses, but it's a passage that's very familiar to us for Christmas. But it connects us with this idea of glory. It says, "Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger.' And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.'" Glory. That's the first thing we're going to talk about this morning. Glory. The idea of glory is related not in word. You know, they don't come from the similar root, but it's related in idea to that idea of honor that we talked about last week. Honor asked, what do we conclude about something or someone? You know, when we look at somebody, look at something, we size them up, we evaluate them, we make we discern, you know, again, it asks, what value do we place on it? And like last week, we said, well, is it a discount item? You know? Is it something, you know, like we said, you get what you pay for? Is it something or someone that is worth the price? That is honor. Glory is almost a response to those types of questions. You know, if we ask, is God, or what is the price that you place on God? Is God worth the price? There has to be an answer. There has to be a response. If we say, is he worth it? Well, the response is yes or no. If we say, what is he worth? Well, that's a lot longer of an answer. But we have considered God, we have considered Christ, we have considered the Holy Spirit, and we recognize that they are the personification of goodness, of holiness, of value. And so based on that recognition, we need to respond. And that response is glory. The glory. You know. Well, how do we give glory to God? Well, it's very interesting. If we look in Scripture, there's a couple different ways that we see people in the Scriptures giving God glory in different contexts. And it's really, and I'll go through them quickly. I know some of you, when I give you this number, you're going to be going, oh, we're going to be here all morning long. Well, and that wouldn't be so bad. I figure we have a 5 p.m. service. If I just keep the morning service going till 5 p.m., none of you will pass out, will you, with hunger? How we give God glory is fourfold. And like I said, I'll be quick with this. Very simply, we look at, we see the context of giving God glory. First, to give God glory, we need to declare our gratitude to God. Luke chapter 17, Jesus reacts when only one of the 10 lepers returned after he healed them. In Luke 17:17, Jesus answered and said, "Were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? Were there not any found who returned to give glory to God except this foreigner?" And he said to him, "Arise, go your way. Your faith has made you well." When we talk about giving God glory, one of the ideas in it is being grateful for what God has done. Another response, and it's kind of it's an interesting response, but it's a double negative, you know. You know what a double negative is? When you have two negatives, which makes a positive. In Romans chapter 4, it talks about Abraham who believed God and he trusted his promises. Because the second way we give God glory is that we do not distrust God's promises. Or the easy way to say it is that we do trust God's promises. Romans 4:20 says, "He didn't waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was able to perform." Have you ever read in Scripture where God gives a promise and thought, maybe he will, maybe he won't? Don't ever do it. If God makes a promise, guess what? He's going to keep it.
Amen.
If Pastor Matthew makes a promise, he's going to try. If the government makes a promise, don't count on it. But if God makes a promise to us, you can guarantee it. It's going to happen. Now, there are some of the promises that people say, well, we don't want that to happen. But it's going to happen. It's going to happen. And giving God glory is recognition that is trusting in those promises that he has given to us. The third response is to celebrate his praises. We've looked at a variety of passages in Revelation. Well, we looked at two passages in Revelation this month. There's also passages in chapter 4, chapter 11, chapter 14. And the difference between gratitude or giving thanks to God. Giving thanks to God very often is described as thanking him for the things that he has done. And are there many things that we can give God thanks for?
Yes.
Many ways that we ought to show our gratitude? Absolutely. Giving him praise is, instead of focusing on the things that he has done, it is focusing on the person of God. All right? And as you go through Scripture, there are many different ways that we describe God as a person. Not necessarily, not through his actions, but as a person. When we praise God for being our Savior, for, you know, it's that idea, that personal part. All right? And it sometimes we split hair because we praise God for being our Savior. We thank God for saving us. You go, all right, you theological people, you like to do that. But it's that idea of celebrating his praises. And the fourth way that we respond is to render God's majesty its due. To give God's majesty its due. Acts chapter 12 shows dramatically what can happen if we don't do that. And this is a great story for today, a great passage for us to read today. Especially, you know, when you get around your Christmas Eve lunch or dinner today, you can bring this passage back up and say, ooh, all right. In Acts chapter 12, it shows dramatically, again, what can happen when we don't do this. Verse 20, it says, "Now Herod had been very angry with the people of Tyre and Sidon, but they came to him with one accord, and having made Blastus the king's personal aide their friend, they asked for peace, because their country was supplied with food by the king's country. So, on a set day, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, sat on his throne and gave an oration to them. And the people kept shouting, 'The voice of a god and not of a man.' Then, immediately, an angel of the Lord struck him because he did not give glory to God. And he was eaten by worms and died." That's one of those passages of scripture that we go, oh, that gives us a nice warm fuzzy. No! But it's not supposed to give us a nice warm fuzzy. It's a warning to us. It's a warning. Because you know what? And we don't see it very often. I will confess that I have never seen somebody say something about God and then fall over dead and be eaten by worms. But I'm not going to put it to the test. We read glory to God. And the truth of the matter is God is glory. We don't need to give it to him because it is who he is. We honor that fact that it is who he is. And so we recognize his glory, and as we do, we need to respond. We give him gratitude. Today, give him gratitude. We trust his promises. Today, trust his promises. We celebrate his praises. Today, do that. And we respect his majesty. That is glory to God. That is what is spoken of in Revelation chapter 5. That is what the angel says in Luke chapter 2. Those angels, when they spoke, they were declaring God's glory, giving him thanks for what he was doing, trusting that he was keeping his promise, celebrating his praises, and respecting his sovereignty, his majesty, his authority. When we sing glory, you know that song, glory, you know, when we sing that, it's a recognition. It's an acknowledgement. It's not just a nice melody. You know, I like that song as the different parts go, you know. It's a recognition of who God is. I want us also, in light of that, to look at another word in Revelation chapter 5, this passage that we read. Last week we noted that this group said something. And it's important for us to say that. You know, we often draw a conclusion, but sometimes we don't speak that conclusion. But they drew a conclusion and they spoke it. And although we often say talk is cheap, we often say talk is cheap, but we also know that words have power.
Amen. Yes.
Especially when those words come from God. God has moved and God has created with just a word. But this morning, I want us to look for a moment at the characteristic, at the adverb that is associated with that word say or saying. Did they just say something? Did they just say, "Worthy is the Lamb"? No. Revelation 5:12 says, "Saying with a loud voice." This gives us a whole other, another aspect of this verse, to this verse, to what is being described here. They weren't just quietly, apathetically recognizing something, you know. Yeah, okay. Okay. Worthy is the Lamb. Yeah. No. They said it in a loud voice. Well, let us consider this word loud. Now, it comes from an interesting Greek word. It's a word that we see, actually, quite a lot, especially if you go in a grocery store. Because this word loud is connected with megas or mega. Now, you ever see in the store mega packs of things? I won't mention, there's a certain particular product that very often comes in mega packs, but I have about that much dignity, and so I'm going to save it. But mega implies what? A lot. Many. Much. Now, when we think of loud, we think of volume. And you know, some of us can get a lot of volume, you know. Some of us use microphones, some of us don't need to use microphones, but the idea is loud, not quiet, generally. But megas or mega means loud, it means great. It implies more than just being loud, more than just having a lot of volume. It implies completeness. It implies greatness. It implies importance. It implies strength. In this word, it has the idea of the widest sense of something. Now, let me ask you a question about our voices. Do any of you know what I mean when I say a library voice? And you know, you can't even really say it when you say library voice. You know, we quiet down. Do any of you know what I say when I mean when I say a conversational voice? You know, we're sitting there. Yeah, I'm not trying to be quiet, not trying to be loud, just trying to communicate. Do any of you know what I mean when I say a mom or dad voice? You know, a minute ago I said that God creates with just words. There's some moms and dads out there that can create an awful lot too with just their voice. Terror, sometimes. Each of those voices, they're a little bit different. They use a different, used in different situations, and very often they get a different response. Now, imagine standing before the God of the universe. Imagine being given an opportunity to express your gratitude, to express your trust, to express your praise, to express your submission. In that one expression, that one statement, that one utterance, we would try to put everything we are into it. That is what this loud voice implies. Our everything. Everything we got. It's not just a lot of noise. It was a voice that encompassed everything that we want to express to our gracious, our loving, our merciful, our providing, our protecting, our sustaining, our creating, our defending, our correcting God. All of that. We wouldn't just flippantly say, thanks. Thanks a lot, God. You know? I was impressed. Lucas came home from school this week with a little hand that taught him how to accept a gift. And I thought, well, that's really pretty nice, you know. And one of the first things was you were supposed to say thank you and mean it. You know, I thought, oh, well, if they have to tell you, you have to mean it, well, then that's a problem. But you know what? Sometimes we say things and we don't mean it. When we speak with this loud voice, it implies that we mean it. We mean it. That brings me to our last point. Hey, I'm doing okay. Our outline, number one was glory, number two was loud. Number three, I want you to write something there. I want you to write your name. And not the words your and name, but Joyce, you put Joyce, you know. Or you put John. Put John there and give him the notes later. And in doing this, I want you to think about this. What would you say to God? What would you say to Jesus Christ? What would you say to the Holy Spirit? How would you express your gratitude to this God to whom the angels said, glory to God, to whom that assembly gave glory? What would you express? How would you express your gratitude? How would you show your trust? How would you demonstrate your praise? And how would you acknowledge your submission? How would you speak glory to God? You see, these are questions that I cannot answer for you. But they are questions that need to be answered answered by you. Answered today. Answered now. You know, as we assemble this morning, we remember the birth of Jesus Christ. We read of the glory of which the angels spoke. We take the words on this page of Scripture and we apply them in our life. What if the angels in Luke chapter 2 were too busy that day to tell the shepherds the good news? What if that assembly in Revelation chapter 5 was too busy to proclaim that truth? Would you do it? What would you say? Glory to God in the highest. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it is truth, that it is power. We thank you for each one that is here. And Lord, as we remember the birth of Jesus Christ, Father, today in this moment, right now, we just stop and we reflect on the truth that there is so much that we would want to say, to give our thanks, to show your praise, to celebrate you, to recognize your majesty. And Father, in this moment, in this time, as we have this time of reflection and invitation, we ask that you would work in our hearts and in our minds to help us recognize that truth, that you are worthy of it. You are glory. And we give you glory. Father, we pray that each and every one that is here this morning can say that Jesus is their Lord and Savior. If there are any here this morning that cannot, we ask that your Spirit would work in their lives. Maybe they have questions. Maybe they have concerns. We ask that they would have the courage to ask those questions. We're happy to answer. And we pray, too, that each one that is here this morning will evaluate how they relate to God and challenge themselves to seriously approach God with an attitude, a heart attitude of glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Will you stand as Jerry comes and leads our hymn of invitation?
The song we're about to sing is a very tender song. And as we sing it, why don't you imagine yourself kneeling at the manger, peering in at the newborn Messiah, thinking how beautiful he is. And as you sing it, don't sing it from your head, but sing it from your heart, sing it from your soul.
Thankful to God for that.
I noticed you said they. You didn't say we. Just kidding. No. Let's be dismissed in prayer before I get myself in more trouble. Father God, we ask that you go with us now as we go to our homes or other destinations. We thank you for the many, many blessings that you give us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.